Okay, good morning, guys, and welcome to our service today. It's going to be online, as you can see, but today I'm just going to enter into a quick prayer, and then we're going to enter into a time of worship. So, dear God, thank you for this day. Thank you for waking us up this morning, Father. We don't take for granted you've given us another day with breath in our lungs. And God, we ask that for people who are online watching, that your presence would just be felt there and experienced there as it is here. And God, I pray that you will just use us today, Father, to make an impact wherever you want us to make an impact. In Jesus' name, amen.
And be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
What's going on that God's forgotten you? Sing these words with us. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and their children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you
and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, He is with you. In the morning, in the evening, in your coming, in your going, if you're weeping, rejoicing, He is for you, 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 He is for you,
UTBAA. We're excited that you are joining us virtually this morning. And as you are in your home with your family, you probably are in your pajamas and your fuzzy socks, and that's okay because guess what? I have on my fuzzy socks today too. I just want you to grab your Bible or your phone where you can access your Bible app. Grab a notebook and a pen and pencil so that you can take some notes this morning. We're going to get started with our message today. Our pre-message charge comes from James 1. Verses 22 through 25. We read this every week. If you follow us either virtually or in person, you're probably familiar with this part of our service, but I am going to read it again. I never want to take for granted this, but this scripture says, "But be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in a mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. But he who also looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it," say continue in it, that's important, "and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer," say I am a doer of the word. Thank you. This one will be blessed in what he does. I am talking about you this morning. So our pre-message charge, before we begin, I just want you to clear your minds and make this commitment as you're listening to today's message. And that is that you're going to take away one nugget or one thing that you're going to use through your entire week to apply from today's message. You know, oftentimes we hear the word, but what good is hearing the word or instructions for our life, and then we walk away and then we don't do the things that we've been instructed to do in the word? So today we will be completing part two of a series that we started last week on decisions, decisions, decisions. Are you choosing life or are you choosing death? So this is part two, but let me just review a couple of things in case you weren't with us last week that we discussed. The first thing that was discussed was the definition, the biblical definition of a choice. So basically a choice is a decision. Another biblical definition of a choice is an acceptance. So in other words, whatever you decide on is what you are accepting for your life. Webster's dictionary definition for the word decision is a conclusion or resolution reached after consideration. After consideration, okay? Consideration meaning you give careful thought to something over a period of time. So when we make decisions, the goal is not to make them aimlessly, like, oh, I'm just going to do that. And here's the thing, sometimes we do that. Sometimes we're driving down the street and our decision is McDonald's versus Chick-fil-A, okay? But what we are discussing is just a little bit deeper than that pertaining to our decisions. And here's why. Our foundational scripture comes from Deuteronomy 30 and 19, reading from the New Living Translation. And it reads, "Today I have given you the choice between life and death, between blessings and curses. Now I call on heaven and earth to witness the choice you make, not the choice God makes." He's already made his decision. It's the choice he allows us to make. "Oh, that you would choose life so that you and your descendants might live. So here's the thing, the decision that you make today doesn't just impact you, but it impacts everyone around you, even people that are not here on the earth presently, but your children, your grandchildren are going to be impacted by the decision that we make. We also looked at the companion text coming from Genesis 2, 8 through 9, also verses 15 through 17 and in the Living Translation. And really what that recants is the conversation that God had with Adam when he's instructing Adam that he says, hey, you know, I give you, you can eat freely from the fruit of every tree in the garden except the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. If you eat of its fruit, you are surely to die. Another companion text from that was Genesis 3, 1 through 7, and here from the New Living Translation. And here is a conversation that Eve is having with the serpent, where the serpent questions her on what God says. This is why, as we go about making decisions, we need to be firm on what we know God told us so that we can act in obedience to it. But then she got a little tripped up when she echoed back to the serpent what God said. It sounded just a little bit different. God said, it says you can eat freely of every tree except the tree of knowledge of good and evil. If you eat of it, you will die. But what Eve said, God said, was that you must not eat of it or even touch it. That's not what God said. It's so, so important that when we are following instructions and making decisions that we say it and do it exactly the way the word of God instructs us to do, not add or take away from the word. So a couple of the decisions that we discussed last week, and again, this is just a review of what we were shared last week. The first decision that we have to make is to decide to be a doer of the word and not just a hearer only. I just read James 1 and 22, I'll read it again, but don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says. Otherwise, you are only fooling yourselves. See, we think we can outsmart God by trying to do it our own way. You can't. You have to do it the way God said. Isaiah 1 and 19. And this is why it's important for us to just obey God's word, because there are promises in his word when we're obedient. This scripture says, if you are willing and obedient, you will eat the good of the land. I don't know about you, but I want to eat good. I want to live good. I want to sleep well. I want to have peace of mind. But it requires that we are willing and obedient. Well, you might ask yourself, well, why are both willing and obedient? Aren't they the same things? No, they're not. Because here's the thing. You can be outwardly obedient, but not inwardly willing. For example, and here's just an application of that scripture. You can pay your tithes every week, but on the inside, you're kicking and screaming, and you're not a cheerful giver, as the Bible says to do. So that's why, see, God wants our heart. This is why scripture says in this passage, if you are willing from the heart and obedient, they go together. You'll eat good. So this is a conditional promise. You can't be obedient and not willing. You can't be willing and not obedient and think you're going to eat good. We have to be, we have to follow God's word exactly as he says. The second decision that we discussed was we need to decide to make and keep God as a priority. Scriptural text for that was Matthew 6 and 33, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto us. Here's the thing. We want them to be added. Rah, rah, rah. We get excited about God adding to our lives. But guess what? It says, but seek him first. So that's on us. That's the decision that we have to make. Also, scriptural reference, Proverbs 3, 5 through 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek his will in all you do, and he will show you which path to take. Here's the thing. There are a whole lot of philosophies out there. But are you seeking God first and trusting in the Lord with all your heart, not leaning to your own philosophy, agenda, and understanding, or the philosophy, agenda, and understanding of Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, or any other social media platform, or even our friends, our colleagues, our family? But are we taking things before the Lord and asking him, God, what should we do? How should we make this decision? Decision number three that we discussed last week was to decide to cast our cares upon the Lord and arrest thoughts of worry and defeat. Now, think about this. We are in a global pandemic that started about 20 months ago. There's been a lot of death. There's been a lot of reasons for concern. Nonetheless, God is still saying in scripture to cast down every argument and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bring every thought into captivity, according to 2 Corinthians 10 and 5. Here's the thing. Yes, the news might be saying this or that a lot of people aren't going to die. It may, and the thoughts may come that you may be thinking that that could be you, that you're going to be in that statistic. But here's the thing. The word says otherwise. You need to arrest that thought and take authority over it. You take authority over it by speaking and declaring the word of God. I will live and not die and declare the words of the Lord. That's how we take authority over thoughts that the enemy might present with things that are around us. Psalm 55 and 22 from the Passion. So here's what I've learned through it all. Leave all your cares and anxieties at the feet of the Lord, and measureless grace will strengthen you. Here's the thing. You cannot handle the situation or carry it yourself anyway. Why not allow God, who is more equipped than we are, to deal with that worry and that concern? Why not allow God to, when you know, and just for example, let's say you're out there and you're dealing with a situation where you're about to lose your home. Now, here's the thing. I'm not saying not to pay any bills and just pray and give back to God. No, we have to be good stewards over what God has instructed us to be good stewards over. But just know this, when you have done all that you can and you know you've done the work of the Lord, then you have to give it to God and let God handle out the rest and the kinks associated with that situation. And just watch what he will do. Decision number four, decide to watch what you say. Scriptural reference for this is Proverbs 18 and 21. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it and indulge in it will eat its fruit and bear the consequences of their words. So we have to watch what we say. You can speak either life or death in a situation. For example, let's say you're dealing with marriage issues and it may seem like that situation isn't going to turn around and you're on the brink of divorce. Start speaking over that husband or wife. Start speaking over that marriage. Remember that your marriage is a trophy that God holds up in the earth. And it's God's good idea. So anything that's God's good idea, he is obligated to cover it and secure it and protect it. You just have to speak the word of God over your marriage. Proverbs 15 and 1 you can reference, but Psalms 45 and 1 was another scripture we talked about. My tongue is the pen of a skillful writer. Some translations say a ready writer. Here's the thing. What are you painting and creating with your words? Because you will have what you say you're going to have just from the words that you speak out of your mouth. So just as we can say negative things and that becomes painted on the canvas of our imagination. You can take those same tongue and you can paint on the canvas of your imagination God's purpose and plan for you. You got to start seeing yourself doing certain things that you know God sent you in the earth to do. And you know what, where it starts? With your mouth. Sometimes it doesn't even make sense. I have said things out of my mouth that after I said it, it was like, uh-oh, am I really believing God for that? And then I realized, you know what? I'm going to believe God for that. It sounded real good coming out. The idea of it sounded good just hearing it come out of my mouth. And then I got in faith for it. So there have been times when I've personally spoke things and I didn't fully understand, but the Holy Spirit put it in my heart to speak it. And then it was like, oh, God, am I really going to be doing that? Kind of like me standing here right now, because if you know me and if you knew me years ago, I would not be standing here. But as an act of my free will and speaking and declaring God's word, because I knew what God was calling me into, I had to start speaking words of faith, even though I was trembling in the process of doing it. But all you have to do is speak it. Trust me, words are not just molecules. They're going out to accomplish something. The words that we speak, they are spirit and they are life. Scripture says, the next decision we discuss, decision number 5, is to decide to believe who God says you are. Last Sunday, and you can go back and look at this service towards the end, we received a beautiful reminder from our children's ministry, Chosen Generation, and they sang a song by Marette Brown, I Am What God Says I Am. They reminded us that, hey, we are fearfully and wonderfully made according to Psalm 139, 13 through 14. And that scripture even says, and my soul knows it full well. So you have to know that you know that you know that in your soul that what God says concerning you is who he says you are. My name is, I'm going to put my whole government out there, Jamie Thomas Lee Holmes. That's my full government name. Ask my parents why they named me Thomas Lee, but that's a long story. But here's the thing. You cannot convince me that is not my name. Even as a child, a few times I tried to change my name because being a female, I wasn't a real fan of having Thomas, a male name, as my middle name. So I tried. So I decided I was going to change it to Tashara, Jamie Tashara Lee. But guess what? It still came back to you are Jamie Thomas Lee Holmes. It didn't matter what my idea of myself was. I am who God says I am. And my parents gave me that name. I'm very proud of that name too. I'll talk about that another time. But 1 Peter 2:9 says, but you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people. You are special to God, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. That is who God says you are. Please, please, please don't speak anything about yourself that isn't who God says you are. You are not dumb. You are not stupid. You are not ugly. You are not worthless. Do not speak those things out of your mouth, because here's the thing. That's not what God's word says about you. You are who God says you are. You are a child of the Most High God. Decision. So now we're starting with new content today. So today we're going to talk about decisions 6 through 10 that God gave me to share. And please hear me that there are many, many things in our life and in the word of God that we need to make decisions on. But these are just 10 that God gave me. So decision number 6, decide to share the gospel and let your light shine. Our scriptural reference for that, the first is Mark 16:15. And then he told them, go into all the world and preach the good news to everyone. So here's the thing. You have an obligation of sharing the word of God and the good news to people in your circle of influence. Now, here's the thing. Sometimes people don't understand, like, what do I say or how do I approach that? I'm not saying you got to scream scripture at them, but why don't you start with your basic Christian testimony. Share with people the things that God did to you, did for you. Share with them what the reason why you have so much joy on the inside when there's always so much chaos going on in the world. Matthew 5:14-16 in the Passion reads, Your lives light up the world. For how can you hide a city that stands on a hill? And who would light a lamp and then hide it in an obscure place? Instead, it's placed where everyone in the house can benefit from its light. So don't hide your light. Say that to yourself. I'm not going to hide my light. Let it shine brightly before others so that your commendable works will shine as light upon them. And then they will give their praise to your Father in heaven. So our lives as believers, it's not to be hidden. We shouldn't be afraid to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. We should be excited to be a light in a dark place, at the Walmart, at the Walgreens, on our jobs, at the gym, at school, in class, wherever we go. We want to be the light of Christ. Remember, our lives are being held up to God as a trophy. Our lives are a fragrance before his throne. But you know that he sends that fragrance into the earth in those places that don't smell so good, that are dark, so that we can be God's boots on the ground and we can be a blessing to people that we come across. So decision number 6, again, is decide to share the gospel and let your light shine. Decision number 7, decide to not be defined by my past. This is a good one because the enemy has a way of echoing the things that we did wrong in our lives to remind us and try to convince us that we're not worthy of the forgiveness that Jesus went to the cross for. Scriptural references, 2 Corinthians 5 and 17. I'm going to read it in the Amplified. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, that is, grafted in, joined to him by faith in him as Savior, that's what it means to be in Christ, he is a new creature, meaning reborn and renewed by the Holy Spirit. The old things, the previous moral and spiritual condition, have passed away. So what that means here is that when you come into Christ, anything that you did in the past, it's forgotten and it's forgiven. Okay? If you're not in Christ, I want you to hear and understand that. All you have to do is acknowledge that Jesus is Lord and Savior and accept him into your heart. God already knows all the things that we've all done wrong. You don't have to list them. All you have to do is receive them. Okay? It is not difficult. I know that there's someone out there that God has been pricking at your heart for some time now. All you have to do is say, God, I recognize my sins. I repent of those sins. Come into my life right now as my Lord and Savior. I receive you now as Lord and Savior in Jesus' name. Amen. And you are now in the family of believers. Okay. So behold, new things have come. Okay. So once that old life is passed, it says, behold, new things have come, because spiritual awakening brings a new life. Okay. That's 2 Corinthians 5 and 17. Philippians 3, 13 through 14 in the Amplified reads, brothers and sisters, I do not consider that I have made it my own yet. But one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and reaching forward to what lies ahead, I press on forward to the goal to win the heavenly prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Here's the thing. When you're pressing, that's a forward motion. No one presses backwards, okay? You press forward. You pull something backwards. So if you are pressing towards the mark, that means you're making a forward motion to the things of God, not to the things of your past. So don't allow the enemy to drag you back, reminding you in your thought process of things that you used to do. I don't care what it is. If you killed someone, it is in, and you repented, it is in the past. Keep it there. Don't play it back in your mind, because the things that you rehearse, the enemy has a way of using those things to have authority over us, and the devil is a liar. Decision number 8. Decide to view adversity through the lens of eternity. Decide to view adversity through the lens of eternity. Our scriptural reference there is 2 Corinthians 4:17, New Living Translation, and it reads, "For our present troubles are small." Okay, "For our present troubles are small and won't last very long. Yet they produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever." So oftentimes in our mind, we make the things that we go through more magnified and larger than they really are. We even make the enemy larger than he really is. And I'm often reminded of the scripture in Numbers where the Israelites went against their opponents, and they came back, and one of the things they said is that they look like giants and we're grasshoppers. But the reality is that their enemy, our enemy, is the grasshopper, and we're the giants because we have God on our side. Psalms 119:50, New KJV version, is, "This is my comfort and my affliction, for your word has given me life." Proverbs 24:10, New KJV says, "If you faint in the day of adversity, your strength is small." And here's the thing, with God on your side, there ain't nothing small about your strength. That same scripture in the Passion says, "If you faint when under pressure, you have need of courage." Here's the thing, you already are equipped with courage. Perhaps you just need to be encouraged. So I am here to encourage you today to know that every good and perfect gift comes from above, and God's placed it on the inside of you. All you have to do is activate it. Be like David, encourage yourself. Know the word so that you can encourage yourself. And if you don't, just go to the word of God and find scriptures associated with your situation so that you can encourage yourself. But if you're in need of courage today, be encouraged by the word and be encouraged by this message today, that no weapon formed against you will prosper. And greater is he that's in you than he that is in the world. There is nothing that the enemy can't use to overtake you, that he would try to overtake you, because he can't, that you can't overcome because of who's on the inside of you. If God before you, then who can be against you? That who can be anything. Don't let the who be you, because you succumb to what the enemy's trying to present. But that who can be family, it could be friends, it could be people on your job, it can be a bad diagnosis from the doctor. But if God before you, who can be against you? You know what the answer to that? Nobody and nothing can be against you. Decision number 9, decide to maintain my confidence in God's promises. Scriptural reference for that is Hebrews 10:35-36. "So do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised. Maintain your position. Do not become weak when you feel that you are under attack. You have to have confidence that God is going to do exactly what he says he's going to do. You know why? Because God is not a man that he would lie, nor the son of man that he would repent. If he said it and he promised it to you, it's as good as gold and you can take it to the bank. Just maintain your confidence and your faith in what God said. Psalms 145:13. "Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures through all generations. The Lord is trustworthy in all his promises and faithful in all he does." Here's the thing. God is not like man. You know how I like to use this example. You know how a kid will say, you know, a parent will promise a child they're going to go to Chick-fil-A today. And maybe they made that promise at 9 a.m. And at noon, the child may ask, "Are we still going to Chick-fil-A?" The parent says yes. And at 5, the child is still asking, "Are we still going to Chick-fil-A today?" And you know why? Sometimes people keep asking the same question over and over and over again, because sadly, we may not have always kept our word and kept our promise. But here's the thing. If God promised it, see, he's a different kind of parent. Not like parents that we may have experienced in the earth. And here in my heart, there are wonderful parents out there. So sometimes we forget and we run out of time and we have to push what we promised for that day to the next day. But here's the thing, God's not that kind of parent. If he promised and he's going to deliver something into your hands, guess what he's going to do? He's going to deliver it into your hands. You just need to continue to trust, believe, and maintain your confidence in God. And decision number 10, decide to persevere and not quit. I have several scriptures I'm going to read for this particular one. The first is Hebrews 10 and 23. Let us hold fast the confession of our faith, the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And we know God truly is faithful. 1 Corinthians 9 and 24. Don't you realize that in a race, everyone runs, but only one person gets the prize? So run to win. Now, I'm not the most athletic person, and I never ran track. I did try. I only lasted 2 days. But nonetheless, where you may not feel physically strong, you are spiritually strong. And you have to run your race in the spirit as if you know you are going to win because it's already done. You don't have to question or wonder if God's going to come through. His word already promised it to you. You just have to continue to believe what God's word says. Isaiah 40 and 29 through 31 says, he gives power to the weak and strength to the powerless. Even youths will become weak and tired, and young men will fall in exhaustion. But those who trust in the Lord will find new strength. They will soar high on wings like eagles. I tell all my Dallas Cowboy fans that God is an Eagles fan, and I'm just waiting on them to get a memo on that. But anyway, they will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. Galatians 6 and 9 says, so let's not get tired of doing what is good. At just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing if we don't give up. Don't you get tired out there. Don't get tired. Stay strong. God is helping you. He's an ever-present help in a time of trouble. At the moment that you feel you're going to break, you are closer than you've ever been to the manifestation of the things you've been believing God for. So don't get tired. In James 1 and 12, God blesses those who patiently endure testing and temptation. Afterwards, they will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love them. So once you've endured the testing and the temptation, scripture says you're going to receive the crown of life. You're going to receive the manifestation of the thing that you've been believing God for. So our reminder charge, this was just not just for you. It was for all of us. And I just want you to take this word that you heard today and apply it to your life. Share it with someone. Share this broadcast. Share the word, your notes, however you've taken them or written them down in your phone digitally, with someone that you know it needs it for this week so that they can be encouraged to do the word of God and be a witness for him and for his people, according to Matthew 5 and 16. I'm just going to pray us out. Father, we just praise you. We magnify you. We thank you, God, for your word. We declare and decree that your word is falling on good ground, Father. We ask, God, that as we depart from this time together, Father, that we will never leave your presence, Father, that we will continue to be grounded in your word, Father. And Lord, I just want to speak over those that out there that may not know you. If you do not have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, I pray that you prayed the prayer that I spoke earlier, but I will repeat it. That, you know, because I want you to know and understand that God wants you in his kingdom. He's not asking that you come to him with a list of all the things that you've done wrong in your life, because he knows and he sees all things. He just wants you to receive him into your heart. Romans 10, 9 and 10 says, if you confess with your mouth, believe in your heart that Jesus is Lord and Savior, you shall be saved. So I want you to do that right now and just say, Father, I come to you. I repent of all of my sins that I have committed. I recognize that Jesus is Lord and Savior of my life, and I receive Jesus now as my Savior. I want you to come into my heart now in Jesus' name. Cleanse me of all righteousness and make me new in Jesus' name. And if you prayed that prayer, we encourage that you get into a good Bible-believing church as in your neighborhood or somewhere where you can go and grow your faith. We encourage you to establish a prayer life with daily prayer and time with God and reading your word. You are welcome to join us here at Understanding the Bible Ambassadors Assembly, better known as UTBAA. We meet every Sunday at 10 a.m. at First State Military Academy, located at 355 West Duck Creek Road, Clayton, Delaware. And if you also just want us to partner with you in prayer, please comment in the chat, or you can send us an inbox message, and we will get back to you with information and some words to encourage you on whatever it is that you believe in God for. Again, we thank you for joining us today. We bless you in Jesus' name. We pray that you have a good, good week, and you continue to serve our good, good God. In Jesus' name, amen. Bye-bye.